Have chats.
And excellent.
We have chats.
And you cunts don't mind if we swear.
That's right. Feel free to pass off. You've been doing this now for a little under 10 years.
Directing.
You've been doing this for a little under 40 years.
Yeah.
How did the two of you come together in the first place?
Well, I knew four times more than he did. And he needed some help.
How am I going to get ahead of this business? I went to a drama school, and I mean, in terms of how we kind of met, I went to a drama school, and at that drama school, we had playwrights writing plays, and I happened to be lucky enough to see a play that John was performing at the time, and completely randomly, this is when I was studying theater and stuff. And so I saw John in this play, which was later on to become a film, and just saw him in a different way, because everyone in Australia knows John Jarrett. And I had a perception of his work, which was, he played, you know, dozens of characters, but generally kind of likable, nice kind of guy. I saw him as a character, very, very bad, like a really evil, twisted, kind of dark character. And it just lodged in the back of my brain that, wow, this guy has incredible range. And I just saw him in this new kind of way for myself. Mm. And then years later, when we were casting Wolf Creek 2, Wolf Creek 1, the idea struck, the idea came from the notion that basically people who get in the truck with these serial killers really like the guy that they get in with. I thought, who's more likable than John? And wouldn't it be great to have someone like John do it? And then I met John, and then he knew so much about the character because he understood the world of the character in a really profound way. And that's sort of how we sort of met.
Yeah. Because I was born and raised in the outback, in the bush. Mm-hmm. So I understand those kinds of characters. And And the Wolf Creek guy himself is basically an impersonation of my dad, who was an outback, bushy, very funny, larger-than-life larrikin, but he wasn't a psychopathic murderer or anything. I just added psychopathic murderer to that impersonation. Yeah.
So was it fun, the idea of taking on a character that was this extreme?
Yeah, because he's anathema to me. You know, I'm a father of six, and him, he's a father. But it's a weird and wonderful world to look at. You know, I mean, the history of humankind is splattered with it since Jesus was a boy, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not that long ago that we had the Ku Klux Klan, and not long before that they were killing Jews in Germany. You know, so human beings do this sort of crap. Doing this sort of crap.
That's right.
So it's an interesting, it's an interesting thing to look at from an actor's point of view.
Yeah.
You know.
And I think it's you know, people are generally fascinated with the evil. I mean, that's why there's so many crime shows. We love finding out about people and what they do. And when you have a character like Mick Taylor, who is, you know, an extremely dark character, but also very, very believable. There's nothing about the character that hasn't really been done by people, because he's based on a couple of true cases out of Australia. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, for a writer, and I think for an actor, it's a complex thing, and it's hard to get right, because you can get it really wrong as well and make a joke of it. And, you know, the character is not a joke, even though he has a lot of, there's a lot of laughs in the new film. Mm-hmm. It's very serious, because it's a challenge to kind of get inside that head truthfully and then to portray it truthfully. Mm-hmm. And I think the key thing, you know, John and I realized after the first movie was the notion of, to play the character, you have to play it and not judge it. And that's really difficult when the character is like a really terrible, you know, horrible character. I mean, and that's the skill, I think, from, you know, that's the thing I love about John's performance and working with John is that ability to detach and fully inhabit this other character and become it and be that for the duration of the performance. And it's, I mean, testament to John's
work. You just
work.
Have to find a way to justify it, basically.
Mm.
That Mick justifies it. Like, I'd never justify it, but he's justified it in his mind that it's okay, you know, that it's a fun thing to do, and they're bloody tourists, you know, the same as in this country, they're just blacks, you know, mm-hmm. and he's got the same feeling towards that. And in our country, it was just blacks too at one stage. And it's that sort of, that inhuman thing that the serial killers tend to give these people, is they're worthless, it doesn't matter, and you can have fun with them. And the humor comes out because he really enjoys it. It's a game. He plays a game. And he has the time of his life. He has so much fun. So there's got to be comedy in it, because is having a ball.
Yeah.
The other, and these victims aren't, obviously.
Yeah. No, they're not having a good time.
Well, it's almost like he gets to a point where he could stop, and it would be, you know, I'm having one on you. Instead, he puts a knife through their head or whatever, but there's such a charm to the character that you kind of like, and I mean, there's a, he has a message. He's definitely saying something every time. But it's,
You see, it doesn't matter, because that's what's got to happen eventually, but, you know, it's like pig shooters that I knew in central Queensland when I, in Australia, who threw the gun away and chased the pig, you know, wounded it first and then chased the pig. Mm. And the macho thing of diving on a boar pig's back, pulling its head up and cutting its throat, it'd be much easier to shoot it. But
the fun.
But it's not as much fun.
Yeah.
And as, and that's that kind of outback cowboy madness, you know?
So the pitch of the tone of the first movie seemed to be a step blacker than the second movie.
Yeah.
Was it, is that a matter of the moment in time you were making the movie, and that was the tone of, that was popular, that you thought was interesting at the time?
It wasn't popular then because, you know, there hadn't been, you know, in 2005 when the first film was made, none of those other movies had come out yet. Saw hadn't come out yet. Hostel hadn't come out yet. So all these movies that had a similar kind of 70s authenticity really came out at the same time, and everyone just happened to at the same time. I think a bunch of people who liked those kind of films just got sick of films that were not taking horror seriously, or everything had a smirk on its face and it was ironic horror. And independently, different directors and filmmakers thought, wouldn't it be great to see an honest to God, genuinely terrifying, really intense horror film, the way they used to do it, like Deliverance, Alien,
Psycho,
just Psycho. Genuinely fascinating kind of serious horror films. So the first one was definitely in that tone, and just that was just because it was reacting a little bit to the films that I was dying to see, which was in that intense kind of horror film. The second one necessarily had to be different because we know from the start of this movie, we know exactly who the bad guy is. So you can't play the same game. The entire film was basically saying, what's the movie about? And you meet John's character. You don't know that he's the monster until halfway through.
Right.
And then the movie's kind of over. So this film is basically all about, now we center stage, this is his story, this is about this character developing him to the next level.
Because the first one was about slowly letting the monster out of the cage.
Yeah.
But the monster's out of the cage.
That's right.
So people say, oh, it's a lot funnier but a lot more intense. I said, but it was funny and intense when the monster came out in the last one, you know.
Yeah, right.
It's basically is the same character, but you do learn more about him because he's there for 90 minutes instead of 50 or
whatever.
That's right. It was.
I mean,
physically more opened up.
The scale of the film?
The second film. More like Mad Max in some ways.
Yes. Absolutely.
More of that spirit.
You know, it was, I mean, we were able to kind of do in the first film lots of things. I mean, the first film was a tiny budget film. This was a bit bigger. So we were able to actually go to the places we really always wanted to go. And we could actually we shot it in a town called Hawker out of South Australia, which is a little town in the middle of nowhere. And in the first film, we could kind of get to one side of the town. This time, we could actually explore the entire region and go way up to different areas and shoot in this beautiful landscape. And so we really got to showcase it in an amazing way. Also, it's full of incredible highways and beautiful mountain ranges. And, you know, the landscape was a character in the first movie, but this time around we're even, you know, able to take it further, I think.
Yeah, it's more of an action-adventure film rather than a creepy film.
Yeah.
You know? And of course, you get your knockers, but if you made it similar to the first one, everyone would say it's just like the first one. If you make it separate...
Yeah.
A different ball game, which it is. It's much more high energy and action. And,
it is.
And they're whinging about that, you know, some boring critics. But you're never going to win. But with a sequel, there's always going to be knockers. But I think what Greg did was terrific. He just picked it up and turned it into something else. But it was the same.
Yeah, essence.
Same backbone, same essence.
Yeah, yeah.
But much more exciting and just as scary as far as I'm concerned. Yeah.
And I think some people find it scarier as well. I mean, and also, you know, going into what John was saying, it is funny to read people say, certain people, not many actually, because they had a great response so far, is people saying, oh, I really wanted it to be like the first one. It's like, well, why don't you go rent the first film and watch that again? Because this is a new movie and it's a different story. Yeah, so, yeah. Yeah, screw those
people. So you can never win with sequels. No one can.
So you call up and say, hey, we're getting the band back together. That's
this band?
Yeah.
For the movie?
I mean, what
it was a long phone call. Was that called 3 years earlier?
No, the band was down the back in a hall playing for 4 years.
I know. Look,
we never split up.
It's slightly in the bloody movie. It took so long to dick around. We couldn't organize a...
You couldn't either a brothel with a handful of 50s.
Yeah. it took us a while to get around to it. But we eventually did. And it was, the thing is, look, by way of justification, the script was developing the entire time we were trying to get the film up. So each time we'd go back to it and look at it, we'd say, is it good enough? Is it ready? And part of the reason the film, I think the film really works very well is because it's a very, very developed script. And it does take a while to work out how to do those things and how to make it work and make sense.
Greg always said he wasn't going to make a sequel until he felt it was better than the first one.
Because otherwise it's like...
If
the film came out and people said it's really not as good as the first one, then we've wasted our time. You've got to say, first film is what it is, it did its job. This has got to be, as a movie experience, as good or better as the first one. And I personally believe it definitely is.
And then we hammered the crap out of it. Greg and Aaron wrote the script, we got it to a point, and then we workshopped the living daylights out of it. So it was worth the effort.
So what's a workshop like on something like this?
Well, there's a bunch of levels. There's the scripting process, then when we get into production, then we do rehearsals, and then John, we start working out different ways to do things. We have a scene, we go in and pretend, we just go in with the actors and with John and work it out, and just play through the scenes. Sometimes some scenes stay the same, but a lot of scenes we just say, wouldn't it be better if we did this or said this? And then it changes again when we're shooting, because sometimes you get to set and you say, that doesn't really make sense anymore. And it's organic all the way through. And then even when we're cutting, we'll be thinking about things and saying, actually, that line isn't working, or let's do another line. And so
In the early days, when we were working the script, as it turned out, we worked a hell of a lot more than we wanted to, because this bloody, I can't think of a word without him wanting to sue me, pulled all the money out of the movie.
The other words,
and
cunt.
We had to pick up and refinance the film. So we had plenty of time working on it. But no, we do things
so
like...
So that was in the first one?
Like, I'd read...
The second one.
Reading this script and I'd ring up and say, how about we put Mick on a horse?
Actually, that's right. That was not in the script.
Things like... But lots of little things that...
Yeah,
he's very inclusive, you know, and
was
we work well
together. Was it the same kind of thing when you were doing the first one? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
It's always, that's some part of your process.
I like to basically, you know, for me, like, one of the biggest thrills for me working on a film and doing film is working with actors, because you work with really good actors and they improve what you have. And you go into a scene and say, here's what I wrote. It's my best version. And even if you have 10 writers it's never going to be as good as an actor spontaneously relanguaging something into what they really, how they would really say it. And John has a very personal connection to the character, because he really does understand the language and the mentality of people from that part of the world. So I'm more than happy for John to keep, we just develop it. And also, we bizarrely, even though we're quite different ages, we have a very unusual connection. We both like...
We bounce well.
We both kind of riff on a couple of things. Like, we both like certain kinds of music, we both have a kind of a connection on a couple of things. So we just end up sort of standing around trying to be silly.
Yeah, yeah, we call it Beavis and Butthead.
Beavis and Butthead. Because he'll
come up with things like, how about Mick sings, the hills are alive with the sound of murder or something. And I go, which means that's Beavis and Butthead moment. It's fucked up.
And then I'll say, what about if you know, then
good.
John say,
no,
what about
sorry.
If I, yeah. What about if I get the knife and go like that and then do that? And I go, it's really silly.
So we do the Beavis and Butthead, which means we've gone too far.
Yeah.
Forget about that.
But the thing is, I think the line between, there's a very fine line, you know, horror and comedy are very, very close together in that true, really intense, genuine horror and disturbing stuff is so close to comedy in terms of genre. And you can jump over that line where things become, the only way to respond to it is laughter because it's so silly. But on the other hand, if you take it seriously, it's very terrifying. So you kind of got to weave that line, because there's a lot of humor in this movie and people are surprised, I think, going, the guy was driving a truck through a mob of kangaroos and I was laughing my head off. People are loving the comedy. But at the same time, it's horrific. And I think they're feeling entertained by actually feeling kind of pushed and pulled between what they're meant to feel about this thing.
Yeah, but Greg's right. There's a fine line between what we're doing and a Warner Brothers cartoon.
Yeah, that's right.
You could easily, yeah. And occasionally he'd reel me back from a bit of that, you know.
Yeah,
and it's very tempting because it's funny, you know. but
you can,
didn't go too far.
That's right. You've got to keep it all focused on telling the story and being true to the character.
Well, the history of the genre also has plenty of that. I mean, we got Jason and, you know, Freddy and all that, they kind of went to the point where it was, okay, now it's a parody of themselves, yes, in a way. And it's a weird place to go. You know that it's kind of over when you start making fun of yourself.
Even The Shining, here's Johnny.
Yeah. You know, it's, yeah, yeah.
All the lines you remember from these great horror films are funny ones.
Yeah, that's right. Mm.
That's so do you find out on set, or is it all really locked down by the time you get to set? Is there a version of this film that could have been cut that did cross the line?
Greg,
differently?
Yeah, and Greg never says cut.
I can't say that word.
He just doesn't say it.
I don't know how to say it.
But with digital, with digitals, it's not like the old film, you know, where you're wasting.
We shot the first one on film, I assume.
Digital.
Digital. One of the early ones.
You were cutting edge back then.
Yeah, cutting edge.
We were.
But it's not like the old days when the spaghetti's just running through. With digital, you can just let it go. And Greg often lets it go to see what happens. Usually shit happens, but sometimes you get a gem.
Sometimes the best thing is trying to, because all you're doing, you're just trying to capture moments of truth, like trying to capture spontaneous things to happen. That's why I like to keep it quite fluid, because you're looking for that moment you could never possibly plan. That's when you've got something amazing, when you've got an actor who's really in the character who is able to just be in the space and be performing. And it feels authentic because they're really genuinely coming up with things on the spot, as opposed to, I say my line, you say your line, and that's a scene. You know, I'm really interested in that kind of performance style because it feels much more interesting and organic as an audience, I think.
We can really see it with some of the actors, particularly with the terrorized people.
Were pretty scared because John was, when he's in character, it's pretty scary. I mean, they weren't, not much acting required from those kids.
No. And we haven't cast any kid I can't bash up, which is pretty sick because I'm 30 years older than most of them.
Well, there is the point, you're the only one doing the press, so I guess maybe the rest of the cast is not.
Yeah, they're not
where they are.
They're 6 feet under.
So he'll employ Hugh Jackman next time and bash the shit out of me.
As Wolverine.
So how do you know, so this movie was not something they were clamoring to fund?
Oh no! Essentially, lots of films, you go to many paths to find the financing. We had the financing set up, one part fell away, and then we put it back together in a different kind of way. So movies are like that. They're kind of houses of cards.
Well, this guy pulled a plug at 5 minutes to midnight. We're in pre-production. It was just a shit of a thing to do.
It happens. It happens a lot of times. But
it just seems like a film that people would have been pushing you to do it for quite a while.
It was not ever going to be made.
It's just a question of time.
Yeah, it was just, we had some bad luck.
So how does this fit into your career? I mean, do people now see you as that guy?
Well, it's a double-edged sword. It's a double-edged sword. It sometimes works against me because, you know, it's an iconic kind of performance. I sound like a wanker, you know. I was so fabulous.
Well, you were pretty good.
But it's, some producers can't see part. They say, what about John Jarrett? Oh, no, they'll think it's that Mick Taylor guy. So it does work against me a bit. But, you know, in the balance, I can't be whinging. I've got a film that's going well internationally.
Have you been cast typed like that before? Because you've been around, you've been doing this since really the beginning of Australian cinema, as we know it.
As Greg said, I've usually played good guys and, you know, nice country boys and not a lot of evil characters.
Nice country boys. John departed the nice country boy. We played by John Jarrett tonight in a country practice. Nice country boy.
Yeah. Well, if you look at some of your early films, you were casting the pretty boy.
Excuse me.
I'm just laughing about it. I'm just seeing like a Gillian Armstrong romance.
Yeah,
like in the 70s.
I know what you're saying. You explain it. I don't know.
No, but you did play a nice country boy.
Some big girly poofed us before this part.
Yeah. But they did cast you as a pretty boy early on. You were cast as a pretty boy quite often early on.
He's a very pretty boy now.
I used to be a pretty boy.
He's very handsome.
Yeah. Yeah, not bad for a
He's a handsome killer. He's 102. It's amazing. It just looks
good.
So how do you know when it's done? Do you test it?
We do, yeah. We do. We had a great editorial process on the movie where we had a theater just next to the screening room, so we're able to do cuts and then test it with friends, and we do sort of five or six different tests ourselves, and it's really just refining and trying and you know, because these movies really are for audiences. If they don't work for an audience, they don't work at all. Mm. So for me, it's, again, getting back to the horror comedy thing, the two hardest genres, I think, I mean, it's all difficult, but horror is very hard and comedy is hard because if you don't, if it's rhythmically not working, nothing else matters. So a scare sequence or a suspense sequence either works or it doesn't work. Mm. Or like in comedy, a joke either works or a setup either works or it doesn't work. Mm. Whereas a lot of other things you can kind of get away with and muck around and it's like, is it working, is it not? No one's really going to respond. Horror, like the audience, you're building them to a point and then it either pays off and everyone does the thing they're meant to do, which is laugh or scream or whatever, mm. or it doesn't work. So it's very much about, I mean, for me, useful having that process of testing because you can.
Most definitely.
John came down for the test as well to see how it's playing, and then we had the distributors come in. So it's interactive with everyone making the movie to see.
The good thing about test audiences, you get a universal bunch of yeses and a universal bunch of noes. So if you get enough of those, you know it's true. You know?
Yeah.
If 27 out of 30 people said that's shit, well, it's shit.
It's shit.
And do you mind watching yourself, or do you enjoy
it? I like watching myself. I'm not going to sit here like all these wanker bloody actors who are full of shit. I'm sorry, they are full of shit. I never watch myself.
All other actors.
You know, I never watch myself. I can't watch myself. If I was can't you watch yourself? You're a bloody good actor, aren't you?
Maybe they're still bad. If I was an actor, I would probably want to watch my films all day.
Yeah.
I just have on loop. Like that's it's like
I can watch a film and say, hey, God, I nailed it. God, I was good there. Or I can watch and say, that's shit. You fucked that scene up, you know.
Do you know whether you've nailed it when you're on set?
Hmm?
Do you know whether you've nailed it when you're on set?
I do.
Yeah, I do.
You know whether he's nailed it? Or
that's my job.
Yeah, well, he knows, yeah.
That's my job.
Yeah, he definitely knows. He told me to go again.
But you know, generally, I mean, not just this movie, but
usually, yes. Usually I say that's it. And usually he says, yeah, that's it. Or he might say, no, I think you got one more. So,
are usually right. Are less fussy than some others?
Yes.
Hugh
Jackman has his dinner in the tent with everyone else, for instance.
So does Russell Crowe. Russell
Crowe. Rusty, yeah.
But I mean, that's the attitude is just not, we just work and do the job.
You know, when you become a well-known film actor, I don't remember the coronation ceremony. And the crown and the throne.
Hang around LA long enough.
Yeah, right. Getting back to Australia quick.
Don't remember that happening.
When are you going back to Australia? Yeah. Next time we do the next
one. One of my favourite sides is these brain surgeons. He says, and they're cutting away at a brain, and the surgeon turns to his mate and says, hey, it's only brain surgery. It's not like we're making a movie.
True.
No, I think that's all overrated. I mean, all we do is we're good at impersonating human beings. We learn our lines, don't bump into the furniture. It's not that hard.
And some people can't do that.
Yeah.
Well, it's a weird thing. I mean, it does seem that the British and the Americans seem to have kind of a different attitude, or the Australians, excuse me, seem to have a slightly different attitude. In America, I guess there's a sense of stardom and skyrocketing and all that, and it seems like everybody, a lot of the conversations.
I think it's to do with the relationship with celebrity and what that means. And I think that, in Australia, I think, and I can't speak for England, but in Australia, the relationship, it's different culturally, what that stuff means. Like, in Australia, if people see a famous person in the street, they tend to actually have a lot of respect for it, and just kind of like, they don't tend to go up and generally go up and clamor and photographs. It's getting a little bit different now. Like, it's changed in the last 5 or 6 years, but I think there's generally a kind of level of, like, respect for someone's thing, but it is pretty out of control here, like the whole TMZ thing, and just, you know, someone's famous and 10 helicopters following around. It's just really hard to keep one's sanity.
Australia is very famous for what we call the tall poppy syndrome.
Yes, that's right.
You heard of that? We cut
anyone Aussies, who puts their head up.
Cut the tall poppies. We don't like people who are full of themselves. As a country, it works both ways.
Yeah, because it can be good because it means that, you know, people kind of keep their generally kind of are trying to be a bit more, keep things in perspective. The bad side is it can be a bit depressing because someone goes and does some incredible thing and people are like, oh, that's shit.
Yeah, that's like, right. If you get amazingly successful, and, like Russell or Hugh, there's a few million Australians that can't wait for you to fall ass over it, you know.
But that's a little true here also.
I'm sure it's a bit of a universal trait.
We in Hollywood like to build them up so we may kill them down
right.
As quickly as possible. Have you ever tried to come to Hollywood and do the Hollywood thing? Is that ever interesting?
Well, I came over here with Wolf Creek 1 And I stood around for about a month, and they said they'd take me on if I came and lived in LA. And I didn't want to live in LA because I actually make my own films now.
Because of him.
He's just directed his first feature film.
And so because of him, because he talked you into it, or because...
No, I did this film with these guys, you know, and when I met Greg, I said, so what have you directed? And he, nothing, feature film-wise, and no. And the DOP, nothing. What are you shooting? Digital. I wasn't used to digital.
And just like, I said, really? Well, and, right, it's going to be good.
How are you going to get the English actresses? I'll get Australians.
I mean, it wasn't...
To play English.
On paper, it sounded pretty bad.
I'm going...
So the reason for me to do this film is...
I think we're in trouble. I think we're in trouble. But anyway, he exploded off the screen. The cinematographer was absolutely amazing. The girls, even English people, didn't know they were Aussies. Mm-hmm. So, and I thought, these bastards just made a movie. And they've never done it before, and I've been around forever. That time I got off my ass and started doing the same. So it was through working with them that I thought, I'm going to have a go at this too.
And do you feel like you're part of this generation of Aussie filmmakers, or are you part of the horror group? I mean, Shot and all that stuff.
No, he's the school captain of the latest round of Australian filmmakers, you know?
I guess we sort of all know each other vaguely, some more so, like I'm friends with a couple and other people I know about. But look, everyone just does their own thing. Like, there's you know, I think everyone genuinely wants everyone else to be successful. And every time one of those guys or an Australian director does something, I'm delighted that they get their success. And I mean, everyone's enthusiastic about making movies in Australia and happy when someone else, so when
that's
does
one
well.
Thing within our industry that we really love it when other films do well, you know. There's no competition like that.
Absolutely.
And we're actually here on one of your sets.
We are
here in the US
in Hollywood in glamorous Hollywood. Glamorous downtown.
Yeah.
We're about to go and shoot the last... I've got one more week to go on shooting this movie for Blumhouse over here.
And Blumhouse seems to kind of have actually the attitude that you made your films with.
They are very much get a camera, go out and shoot a movie, here's a bit of money, go do it. And it's great. I mean, you know, being in Australia, we have a very low budget film industry generally because we don't have a huge studio system. So films are made between $1 to $5 to $10 million generally. Mm-hmm. So for me, it's like, this is not that dissimilar to being at home because you get a very tight schedule, great crews. The crews here are amazing. The American crews are awesome. Yeah. So it's good fun. It's a good little good match.
So are you interested in staying here and moving to Hollywood and doing all that, or are you really...
We're going back home to post-produce this film in Australia. We've got to have a great post team there. And then we'll see. I really don't know what's going to happen next. I would love to do a big film.
In these modern times, you don't have to live in LA anymore. Because of internet and you have to be here to make the film, but everything else leading up to it and post, you don't have to.
Well, what if he wants to make $8 million movies? If you're inspired to 80 and 120,000,
I would love to do
movies.
But none of them will be shot in America anyway.
Australia.
They'll all be shot in Australia. Yeah. They'll be shot in Bulgaria.
Peter Weir lives in Palm Beach, always has done. You don't have to live in LA. I mean, the film world is very international now. I mean, 30 of the biggest stars in the world are Australians now.
But having said that, I probably will move to LA.
I mean, do you want to make a Marvel movie?
I would love to do a Marvel movie.
You don't want to be an intimate filmmaker. You like the idea
absolutely.
Of making some
sizes. Oh, for sure. I mean, the one we're doing right now was a script that was being around, and we just found the perfect place and way to make it. But, you know, would I love to do a huge $100 million movie? Of course. Mm. Every filmmaker wants the bigger palette.
Everybody wants to be in one of them.
For sure.
And if they call you and they say...
I'll leave skid marks.
No. You'd say no. I'd rather
make a kick I'm just a shitbox film in Dubbo in Western New South Wales.
Yeah. I'm just a young farm lad.
I'm just a nice guy. I don't want to come over here.
And Wolf Creek 3 or 3D?
Wolf Creek 3D.
Wolf Creek 3D.
Is that even a thought at this point? Or?
It's definitely a thought. We are going to see what happens. The film's coming out. It's on VOD right now in the States. It's coming out in theaters, I think, next week.
Yeah, May 16th.
May 16th.
In Burbank, in LA.
And we hope it really goes very well. And if it does, we're talking about it all the time because the character has become an iconic horror character. We love doing, they're fun, very fun movies to make. We like working together. It would really be about this film, people loving this film, which it seems they're embracing it, and then finding the right script, because if it's not a good script, then it's not worth doing. And again, the challenge is now we're saying, well, we made a really great little film that we're very proud of. We made a bigger one that's actually on par. So the next one would have to be really good. So now we'd have to work it out. But you know, we'll see.
We'll see.
But the thing is, if we were going to do it, there's no way we would wait. It would be very soon. It wouldn't be. Last time there was a huge amount of time, which worked in one way because we've got an amazing script and it worked really well. But next time we'd go quickly.
But we've got three or four scenarios on the boil.
Yeah, Mick in space.
Yeah.
Mick versus the Russians.
Yeah.
Mick versus Vladimir. Putin. Mick and Putin going toe to toe. And then we've got Mick versus Predator. He goes to the Predator planet and kills them all. These are just, don't put these on the video though, because we don't want people stealing our ideas, because it's such good ideas.
There'll be lawsuits.
Mick versus Alien. I mean, look.
We've got Putin, though. I think that's good.
Mick versus Putin.
Excellent.
I think Mick might lose.
Mick would get his ass handed to him.